Simon & Schuster Audio presents Clean Meat. How Growing Meat Without Animals Will Revolutionize Dinner and the World by Paul Shapiro. With a foreword by Yuval Noah Harari, author of Sapiens. Read by George Newbern. Foreword by Yuval Noah Harari. Today, most of our planet's big animals live in industrial farms. We imagine that the Earth is populated by lions, elephants, and penguins, roaming freely across vast savannas and oceans. That may be true of the National Geographic Channel, Disney movies, and children's fairy tales, but it is no longer true of the real world outside the TV screen. The world contains 40,000 lions and 1 billion domesticated pigs, 500,000 elephants and 1.5 billion domesticated cows, 50 million penguins and 50 billion chickens. In 2009, a census counted 1.6 billion wild birds in Europe, including all species together. That same year, the European meat and egg industry raised close to 7 billion chickens. A large portion of vertebrate animals living on our planet are no longer free living, but rather are owned and controlled by one animal, Homo sapiens. These billions of animals are treated on industrial farms, not as living creatures who can feel pain and distress, but as machines for producing meat, milk, and eggs. They are often mass-produced in factory-like facilities, and their very bodies are shaped in accordance with industrial needs. The animals then pass their entire lives as cogs in a giant production line, and the length and quality of their existence is determined by the profits and losses of agribusiness corporations. Judged by the amount of suffering it causes, industrial farming of animals is arguably one of the worst crimes in history. Up till now, scientific research and technological invention tended to worsen the lives of farm animals. In traditional societies such as ancient Egypt, the Roman Empire, or medieval China, humans had a very partial understanding of biochemistry, genetics, zoology, and epidemiology. Consequently, their manipulative powers were limited. In medieval villages, chickens ran free between the houses, pecked seeds and worms from the garbage heap, and built nests in the barn. If an ambitious peasant tried to lock 1,000 chickens inside a crowded coop, a deadly bird flu epidemic would probably have resulted, wiping out all the chickens, as well as many of the villagers. No priest, shaman, or witch doctor could have prevented it. But once modern science deciphered the secrets of birds, viruses, and antibiotics, humans could begin to subject animals to extreme living conditions. With the help of vaccinations, medications, hormones, pesticides, central air conditioning systems, automatic feeders, and lots of other novel gadgets, it is now possible to cram tens of thousands of chickens or other animals into tiny coops and produce meat and eggs with unprecedented efficiency, but also with unprecedented misery. In the 21st century, science and technology will give us even more power over our fellow beings. For 4 billion years, life on Earth was governed by natural selection. Soon, it will be governed by human intelligent design. But technology is never deterministic. We can use the same technological breakthroughs to create very different kinds of societies and situations. For example, in the 20th century, people could use the technology of the Industrial Revolution, trains, electricity, radio, telephone, in order to create communist dictatorships, fascist regimes, or liberal democracies. Similarly, in the 21st century, biotechnology could be used in many different ways. On the one hand, we could use it to design cows, pigs, and chickens who grow faster and produce more meat without any thought about the suffering we inflict on these animals. On the other hand, we could use biotechnology to create clean meat, real meat that is grown from animal cells without any need of raising and slaughtering entire creatures. If we follow that path, biotechnology may well be transformed from the nemesis of farm animals into their salvation. It could produce the meat so many humans crave without taking such an enormous toll on the planet, since growing meat is much more efficient than raising animals to later turn into that same meat. Clean meat isn't science fiction. As you'll hear in this audiobook, the world's first cultured hamburger was produced and eaten in 2013. True, it cost $330,000, aided by funding from Google co-founder Sergey Brin. But we should remember that it cost billions of dollars to scan the first human genome, and today it costs just a few hundred dollars. In fact, by 2017, Only 4 years after the first culture burger tasting, the people who produced that first clean burger have already refined their process so that their costs are now a small fraction of that first burger. Competitors have already sprung up, including an American company that produced the world's first cultured meatball in 2016, at a comparatively bargain price of just $1,200. In 2017, the same company produced the first clean chicken sandwich and duck à l'orange for an even lower cost. And they, too, intend to be marketing products in the fairly near future. With proper research and investment, within a decade or two, we could produce clean meat on an industrial scale, which will be cheaper than raising cows and chickens. If you want a steak, you could just grow a steak, instead of raising and slaughtering an entire cow. The transformative nature of this technology is hard to overstate. Once the price of clean meat is low enough, it will make not only ethical sense, but also economic and ecological sense to replace slaughterhouse meat with clean meat. Animal farming is one of the chief causes of global warming, with the United Nations comparing animal agriculture's greenhouse gas emissions to those of the entire transportation sector. Even beyond climate, animal farming is one of the main consumers of antibiotics and poison, and one of the foremost polluters of air, land, and sea. It may be easy to point our fingers at the oil and coal companies when lamenting the planetary problems Homo sapiens are causing, but the conventional meat industry is a comparable polluter. Just as we need clean energy to replace fossil fuels, we need clean meat to replace factory farms. Switching to clean meat will be crucial for saving the planet from disastrous climate change and ecological degradation. In this fascinating and hopeful audiobook, Paul Shapiro highlights the great promise of this new method of food and clothing production: cellular agriculture. Thanks to this method, humans may soon stop raising and slaughtering farm animals by the billions. In the not-too-distant future, we may look back at industrial animal farming with the same horror that we today look back at slavery, a dark chapter in the history of humankind, which we have mercifully left behind us. In the 21st century, technology will give us divine abilities of creation and destruction. But technology will not tell us what to do with it. When we come to design this brave new world, we should take into account the welfare of all sentient beings, and not just of Homo sapiens. We could use the wonders of bioengineering to construct either paradise or hell. It is up to all of us to choose wisely. Chapter 1: The Second Domestication. On a muggy August day in 2014, I found myself wandering through the Brooklyn Army Terminal, a former World War II-era train station in New York's hippest borough, which is now home to several dozen startups. Train cars from two generations ago stood motionless on their tracks, surrounded by brand new and mostly empty office spaces. Could this space, frozen in time, really be the headquarters of a biotech company that, along with several other startups, is currently pioneering a technology that promises to upend our current food system? As someone who's devoted my career to making our agricultural system more sustainable, especially through my work at the Humane Society of the United States, I've visited many food startups that claim their products will save the planet and prevent many of the illnesses that plague us, all while providing enough food to feed the world's growing population. Yet almost invariably, they're located in the Bay Area, close to the Silicon Valley wealth that created them and continues to drive them toward the better future they're seeking to create. To me, Brooklyn seems far more bearded hipster than biotech haven. But this is where Andres Forgach invited me to visit his new company, Modern Meadow. Neither Modern nor Meadow came to mind as I surveyed the surroundings. The former military supply station was bought by New York City in the early 1980s and has since been converted to office space. Now home to several dozen tenants, the station contains mostly startups. One of them, Modern Meadow, is generating headlines around the world. After 15 minutes of searching the terminal and passing several other biotech startups, I finally found the lab's entrance. Forgach, in his late 30s, welcomed me into the humble yet pristine space with a warm smile. Just about a dozen employees worked for him at the time. I wondered if I was really about to see history in the making. After I entered, Forgach and I chatted about the Modern Meadow process, culturing cow cells to grow beef and leather outside of the bovine. In other words, producing genuine leather without having to slaughter the cow from whom it came. The company was founded in 2011 as the first commercial venture to grow meat and leather in a lab. And I'd read that Forgotch could, theoretically, grow the entire world's beef supply from just one microscopic cell. The implications of this technology, if it can be perfected and scaled, are, of course, tremendous, potentially allowing us to continue to eat and wear animal products without causing the suffering, waste, and environmental damage wreaked by our current agricultural system. Although Modern Meadow was the first company founded to commercialize these products, Forgotch isn't alone in his efforts. Several other companies, including all those that will be profiled in this book, have since been founded with the goal of bringing cultured animal products into the mainstream. We toured the quietly humming reactors where the culturing happens, and then Forgotch shocked me with a simple question. Want to try a sample? I came expecting to see, not to eat. And after more than two decades of happily enjoying a vegan diet, the thought of consuming beef wasn't exactly appealing. I was also aware that, at that time, far more humans had gone into space than had eaten meat grown in a lab. Until Modern Meadow's existence, only a few academics had ever actually cultured meat in vitro, and perhaps less than a couple dozen people the world over had consumed it, ever. I've not eaten meat in a very, very long time, so I'm not sure my review would be that valid, I managed to mutter, half joking, and fully hoping I'd successfully talked myself out of the situation. I also contemplated the cost of the food, knowing from news reports that any amount of this beef would have to be worth a fortune. Didn't the burger they just served up in Europe cost $330,000 from cell to bun? I was referring to the now famous first-ever lab-grown hamburger, funded by Google co-founder Sergey Brin, that had been cooked and eaten at a press conference in London just a year earlier. Don't worry, Forgotch assured me. You're our guest, and it's only a small sample. A steak chip, if you will. Really, it only cost about $100 to produce, and that'll come way down soon. I'd certainly eaten a lot of steak fries in my life, but a steak chip was another beast altogether. Forgotch didn't simply want to create cultured versions of foods we already enjoy, like burgers. He also wanted to invent entirely new culinary experiences. The idea for the steak chip, think of them as potato chips made of meat, came from the realization of how much cheaper it would be to make thin sheets of meat than it would be to grow more complex pieces. Just as someone might grab a stick of beef jerky at a gas station for a quick snack, might they also try a bag of steak chips? High in protein, low in fat, and super convenient. I'd want that, Forgotch offered with a grin. Initially on the fence, I quickly recognized the opportunity to be one of the first people ever to try a food that was generating so much buzz and controversy that I decided to accept my host's generous offering. Forgotch pulled the steak chip from its container. I smiled and held it, wondering how my body would react to its first bite of meat in more than 20 years. I had little ethical concern about eating the meat, but it still felt bizarre to be on the precipice of ingesting animal flesh, especially flesh as novel as this. I didn't decide to take a permanent vacation from meat because I didn't like eating it. I always enjoyed it as a kid and still enjoy the plant-based meats that are increasingly popular among omnivores today. Rather, I became vegan in 1993, having learned as a young teenager about the consequences of a meat-centric diet. Humans don't need to eat animals in order to be healthy, and the meat industry causes a lot of problems for animal welfare and the planet. So I figured, why not do what I can to reduce this harm by leaving animals off my plate? Eating lower on the food chain also allows more food to be produced, since so many resources like grains and water are needed to feed livestock. Such efficiency has become even more important as the global population continues to boom. Eventually, my love of animals led me to a career in animal protection, helping to spearhead legislative and corporate campaigns both to gain protections for farm animals and reduce the number of them being raised and slaughtered for food in the first place, by helping people enjoy more plant-based meals. I'd been reading and talking about the concept of growing meat in a lab for years, and always thought it was a promising solution to a vexing problem, but never thought of the theoretical food as a product for myself as much as it was for those who were wedded to meat. Yet here I was, about to add real animal meat, albeit a slaughter-free version of it, back into my diet, at least for the day. The chip looked like a thin piece of jerky. As I stared at it, I contemplated just how remarkable, technologically and symbolically, this little piece of dried beef was. Perhaps I was holding in my hand the answer to so many of the problems animal agribusiness poses for humanity and the planet that hosts us. I raised the meat to my mouth, took a breath, and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.